Ascent Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents A Touch of the Madness, How to Be More Innovative in Work and Life by Being a Little Crazy, by Lawrence Kasanoff. Narrated by Lawrence Kasanoff. For All the Great Scoundrels. Chapter 1, Welcome to the Madness. I wanted to be a movie producer since I was a little kid. And I got lucky and became head of production of an independent film studio called Vestron when I was right out of grad school. By the way, I thought I nailed getting this job because I was such hot stuff, having just graduated with my MBA from Wharton. That lasted about 5 minutes, until my boss, in his welcoming speech my first day, said, "By the way, if you pull any of that business school crap, you're fired." So much for the Ivy League in Hollywood. Okay, back to the story. Vestron rode the boom in home video, which at the time was relatively new and exploding. We were sort of the Netflix of the day. I had to deliver 80 movies a year. Buy them, produce them, co-finance them, doesn't matter, said my boss, but 80 movies a year and don't lose money on any of them. So mostly we made action movies, comedies, horror films, and fun commercial stuff. Then along came this movie called Platoon, and I wanted to make it. This was not at all our kind of film. The people in it became stars, but most weren't stars at the time. The director, Oliver Stone, had done one prior movie which we co-financed, and while I thought it was brilliant, it didn't do much business. Platoon wasn't a catchy title. It dealt with the extraordinarily serious topic of the Vietnam War and how it affected the kids who went. The tagline was, "The first casualty of war is innocence." It was not the kind of movie we were making. To his incredible credit, my boss, Austin First, who was a talented, disruptive entrepreneur, said, "Okay, you're the head of production. If you want to do it, you can do it." But there was a but. "You have to bet your job," he warned. "If it fails, you're fired." He wasn't bluffing. He fired people all the time. "What do you want to do?" I took the shot. Much later, I saw the movie one early morning at a film festival in Italy, right after it had been finished. I am probably the only person in the world who giggled their entire way through Platoon, not because it wasn't amazing, but because the whole time I was thinking, "Oh, thank God, I'm not getting fired." Platoon went on to win Best Picture that year at the Academy Awards. A few months later, I ran into Oliver Stone, the director, at a bar in New York City. "You know, kid," he said, "I always liked you. You have a touch of the madness." "A touch of the madness?" I thought. "Is he saying I am a bit crazy? Was I crazy?" I had to think about that. Then I realized my boss encouraged the touch of the madness by letting a 25-year-old run a huge production slate and take a risk on a movie no one else would touch. I had a touch of the madness by betting a once-in-a-lifetime job to do it. The director had a touch of the madness by never giving up his battle to make a Vietnam movie in a way no one ever had. The whole innovation that was Platoon would not have happened without a touch of the madness. I realized I love that phrase. It hit me. Innovation demands a touch of the madness. First, why does everyone talk about innovation? Why is it so important? The current of the river of life will always try and pull you towards the middle, towards complacency and mediocrity. This is true for every person and every company. It's a problem because other companies that don't give in to that current will eclipse you. Companies and organizations tend to be comfortable with the tried and the true. But the audience, in other words, your customers, are attracted to what's new, different, and better. The best tool you have for swimming against that current of mediocrity is innovation. To grow and become a great company, a great entrepreneur, you must actively embrace it. You can become pretty good without it, but not great. You must take a shot. And to be very innovative, you have to be a bit crazy. You need a touch of the madness. That's what I foster in myself, in my company, and in my movies. It's what companies have to cultivate in their culture, their employees. You can't be great without it. And it doesn't mean to just be a little crazy in what you think up. It also means you must have a mad enthusiasm, a crazy sense of purpose and devotion and perseverance, a touch of the madness in how you create it, implement it, and make it thrive. How to do it? 3 steps. Create. Find the essence. Ask anybody, anywhere, for anything you want. Play it all like a game. Chapter 2, Create. First, create a great idea with a touch of the madness. Simple, right? A touch of the madness gives you some guidelines for how to be more creative and innovative. They are: find the essence of your idea. Know your target customer or audience. Let technology serve your idea, not the other way around. Once you've created your idea, never let go. And do it all with a mad fire in your belly, never give up mindset. Here's the breakdown of the four steps. Essence of an idea. When I decided to make Mortal Kombat into a movie, everyone told me I was crazy and my career would be over. You can't make video games into movies. And every prior attempt had failed. It had never been done successfully at that point. The secret to Mortal Kombat. But here is a secret. I never thought I was making a video game into a movie. I thought I was making the essence of that video game, the thing that made it so successful, into a movie. Think of a game or intellectual property as a pyramid. The game to me was not the apex of the intellectual property pyramid. It was one rung down. The apex is the magic pixie dust that made Mortal Kombat such a great video game. I've always thought with Mortal Kombat, it was empowerment, wrapped in a visually stunning package, of course, but empowerment nevertheless. Martial arts teaches that you don't have to be the biggest and the strongest to win if you focus, study, and do the right thing. And the game really reinforces that. When wandering around an old-fashioned arcade, this was a place in the old days where you went to play games that were in freestanding big console machines, trying to decide if I should bet my career on Mortal Kombat, an 11-year-old kid slapped a quarter down on the arcade game, looked up at me, and said, "I challenge you to Mortal Kombat." Then he beat the hell out of me, and the game egged him on, saying things in that great, deep, resonant Mortal Kombat like, "Sub-Zero wins. Flawless victory. You lose." The kid left feeling great. I decided then and there to go for it. Now, once you have that essence, that top view, you can decide where to sprinkle it. Recently, I was executive producer of a hit Mortal Kombat movie. It was my 19th Mortal Kombat production in 20-something years. I have produced it in every medium in the world. The franchise has grossed almost $10 billion. Here's another one. Several years ago, I went to LEGO to try and get the rights to make a full-length animated film. LEGO had not done that before. They were concerned that if it didn't work, it might embarrass them. So we all decided to make a movie that would go straight to DVD. If it hit, great, and we could go make a bigger one next. If it failed, it would be under the radar and no one would really notice. I raised independent money to make the movie and set a deal with Universal to distribute it. Now, what is the essence of LEGO? This one was easy for us because LEGO knew. The essence was, we build on each other. LEGO, when the characters came to life, was not just about blocks and bricks or kids playing. It was about teamwork and counting on each other and, well, building on each other. We put that into the first full-length LEGO feature film, LEGO, The Adventures of Clutch Powers. It was a DVD hit. We wound up doing LEGO Star Wars, The Empire Strikes Out, LEGO Theme Park Rides, and more, all with that essence infused into it. In my opinion, LEGO's success is not a fluke. They know their essence. Know the essence of your idea. What makes it so appealing and great? Okay, next step to creating great ideas? Audience. Who do you work for? Your boss? Your foreman? Your editor? Your board? No. You work for your audience, for your customers. That's a huge responsibility. Dirty dancing. That's the point, you idiot. When we started Dirty Dancing and Jennifer Grey was brought up to star, I, 30 seconds into the movie business at that point, suggested maybe we needed someone more famous, more glamorous. She was a wonderful actress, but an every woman, I said. "That's the point, you idiot," said the movie's real godfather and my current business partner, Jimmy Einer. "Every woman in the world will identify with her and think they too will get a good-looking bad boy to become a good boy for them. That is your audience." He was right, of course. Kano and the Kid. Here's another example. In Terminator 2, Arnold Schwarzenegger's character, the Terminator, gets half of the skin on his face blown off, revealing his metal exoskeleton beneath. In Mortal Kombat lives a character called Kano, who also has part of his face missing, revealing a metal plate with an LED kind of eye. They looked a bit similar to me, and since I made both movies relatively close to each other, I decided I would redesign Kano as we migrated the characters from the game to the first live-action Mortal Kombat movie. Close to that time, as a favor to someone, we had a class of kids from a junior high school in to see how we build sets and design movies. I was showing them around. Fight rehearsal. They loved it. Goro, the 8-foot-tall animatronic creature, they loved it. Wild statues and weapons from the parallel realm of Outworld, they loved it. Character designs for the movie, they loved. Wait, hold on. When we came to the designs for Kano, one boy started breathing heavily. "Is that Kano?" he asked nervously. "Yep," I said proudly. "But Kano has a metallic eye," he said, now out of breath. I started to worry about the kid. Maybe he was sick. I explained I didn't want Kano to look in Mortal Kombat anything like Arnold in Terminator 2, and he interrupted. He began to hyperventilate. "Kano has a metallic eye patch. You can't change that." "But Kano has a metallic eye patch." He was sweating, breathing quick and shallow. He was in the throes of a full-blown panic attack, all because I was going to change Kano's metallic eye. My mistake hit me. My audience point blank told me what to do. Okay, I said. "You're right. Kano does have a metallic eye patch. We'll change it back." I ripped the design off the board and tore it up. Immediately, he started to calm down. He made me promise again, and then he was fine. What I realized so suddenly was that I wanted to change Kano because I wanted to do something a bit different so I didn't repeat myself, and so I would be creatively challenged every second. But see what's wrong with the previous sentence? It's all I and not my audience. The audience, embodied by that poor kid, couldn't care less about what I wanted, and nor should they care. They wanted their beloved character to look in the movies as he does in the game. We changed Kano back that day, and he remains a popular character in the movies and games 25 years later. Mad Scientist in Japan. We financed at Vestron a campy horror comedy called Reanimator, based on an H.P. Lovecraft novel. It parodied 50s horror movies. The movie featured a mad scientist trying to reanimate, or bring back from the dead, people. It was wild, crazy, over the top, full of gratuitous violence and goofy sex. People loved it, and it became a huge hit. The scene everyone talked about most was this. Towards the end, the mad scientist has the damsel in distress, wearing very little, strapped down to an operating table in his mad scientist lab. Oh, and his head has been cut off, so he carries it around, gripped by the hair in his right hand. Naturally. At one point, the headless scientist stands next to the damsel and, holding his head, kisses her in the cheek, then neck, then his hand and the head goes down out of frame and, well, you get the picture. It became known, and forgive this if you're prudish, as the head-giving head scene. Again, talked about in the U.S. and Europe, but nothing more. In Japan, a different story. Our chief of the Japanese office had other plans. He put the head-giving head scene on the video box. He made posters he sent to every video store in the country. Remember, you couldn't actually see any nudity or anything. It was all implied and more ridiculous than sexy. And he took out ads and billboards. The head-giving head scene became a phenomenon in Japan, and the video became one of the biggest in Japanese history. Why? Because our chief of Japan knew his audience. The Japanese read wild manga and watch over-the-top crazy anime. Our chief embraced this and was not afraid, nor should he have been. He came to New York proudly to celebrate with us and give everyone their own head-giving head posters. Know your audience and act boldly on that knowledge. I have a little speech before we start every movie. You don't work for me, the director, or the studio, I say. You work for the audience, your customers. You have to know them, not just impersonal demographic info, but what they really want. Ideas drive tech. Let your idea drive your technology, not the other way around. See the Eiffel Tower in your mind, then figure out how to build it, versus seeing lots of metal joints and figuring out an idea for them.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.